Good morning, church. It is good, always good, to be in the house of the Lord. So every time we gather together as fellow believers, brothers and sisters in Christ, a few things happens when we gather. Right, the first thing that happens is we encourage one another. We build one another up. We show love towards one another. So never ever fail together. So for those who are online joining us, we welcome you. Good morning. But we really hope to see you back here in us next Sunday. The second thing that happens when we all meet up is we bring and we invite the presence of God, the presence of the Holy Spirit to come and fill this place. You know, when we worship, when we raise our hands, when we sing, God hears. That brings out the presence of God into this place and miracles happen. And finally, when we meet together, when we pray, when we worship, you know what happens? The realm of darkness gets pushed back. Spiritual warfare takes place. And we know that when that happens, the kingdom of God advances. Amen? Amen? So let's commit this time into God's hand. Let's come together with a heart of praise, of worship, of prayer. And let's commit this time into the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we declare that you and you alone are the Lord of this place. That in this sanctuary, that from this pulpit, your power, your presence, and your anointing will fill this place, Father. Father, as we come before you this morning, Father, we ask, Lord, that your presence come and fill this place, that you come and be with us, that you and you alone be high and lifted up in this place, Father. So, Father, this morning, we lift up the worship before you. We lift up our sister Zling and the worship team before you. We ask, Lord, that may you come and anoint their lips, anoint their hands, but most importantly, God, and watch over their heart, Lord. That whatsoever that speaks out, Lord, be powerful and be found pleasing before you. Father, right now, I lift up our brother Martin before you. As he come and break forth the word of life, may you anoint his lips. May you give him wisdom. May you give him special anointing, Lord. That whatsoever he speaks, Father, is powerful, Lord. That you watch over him. That may he share, may he impart, may he teach, may he encourage, may he empower, Lord. So, Father, we commit this Sunday service into your hands. Above all else, Father, we want to reach out. We want to touch you. We want to have a glimpse of your glory this morning. As we commit this into your hands, in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people say,
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church. We come with great anticipation this morning to meet with the Lord. Amen. To the one who is worthy, we will lift up a song of praise. So can I invite you, you know, to look around you and let's welcome one another here in the house of the Lord.
Well, washed away. 'Cause when we see, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day.
Together, Lord, in unity, to lift up one voice and one song to the one who is worthy, to the one who is worthy, Lord, to the God who saved us from our sins. We thank you, Lord, for what you have done. And Lord, we come before you in reverence today to behold the King. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you.
Thank you.
the secret that I find. I'll spend forever in the pleasure I found looking in your eyes. So give me I don't need anything else. You are my one.
Father, just look to Him this morning. We look to You, O Lord. Shiri ala la la. Oh, we lift up a song to You. We lift up a song to You. Shiri ala la. A love song to You, Lord. Shiki ala la la. Kora basu. Church, we're gonna sing a new song. And it's calling upon the name of Yeshua. And I believe the Lord is shifting our hearts to a posture that we look to Him, that we declare that He is our beloved, that we wait and we desire as we posture in that waiting to pursue the one who we love. So wherever we are, we're gonna sing this simple song, but we're gonna declare the name of Yeshua here in this place. Amen.
Beautiful. Above all name, your name is all powerful, your name Your name changes everything. Father, you are wonderful. You are perfect. You are beautiful beyond all description, Father. We declare, Lord, we declare that you and you alone are the Lord of this place. And you alone are the Lord of our lives. And you alone are the Lord of Bethesda. Father, we declare, we say that you are the one worthy, worthy of all our glory, all our honor, all power. Because we say you are the one who has started all this, becoming all of this to you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And our God's people say, Amen. Please be seated. So this morning, being the third Sunday of the month, is when we do and partake of the communion. The communion is a sacred and powerful symbol of our relationship with God. So we humbly ask that for those who have not yet accepted the Lord as their Christ, as their Savior, please observe this silently as you partake of this emblem. The communion speaks of a very powerful, very special relationship between Christ and man. And the symbol of it is that Christ came, Christ died, and we do this always in remembrance of Him. So as you prepare your emblem, let's partake of this together. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Would you lift your bread and let's give thanks. Father, we thank you that you sent your one and only begotten Son to this earth and to die for each and every one of us. With this body, we recognize, Lord, that you have come to save us, and we are safe because of what you have done. Every time we live off this bread, Father, we remember of your love for us. Remember that you have sent your one and only Son to die for us. And with that, we can call you Abba Father. And with that, we can come into your holy presence. So Father, we give thanks in Jesus' name. Please eat of the bread. And in the same way, after the supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. And do this, and whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So let's lift our cup together. Father, we thank you for the blood that was shed on the cross. We thank you that with this blood, there is a new covenant. And with this blood, there is a forgiveness of sin. That all that we have done, it is now forgiven. That with this blood, that we will be cleansed. That we are now ready to come into your presence. That you will abide with us. And we do this in remembrance of you until the day you shall come again. In Jesus' name we pray. Please drink of the cup. Okay. Morning, church. What a beautiful service this morning. What a beautiful worship. Before we start the sermon, we'd like to, of course, welcome anyone who is here for the first time. Do we have any visitors who are here for the first time? Who has joined BC for the first time? We have a sister here. Welcome, good morning, welcome. Glad to see you in the house of the Lord. Anyone else? Oh, we have another one there as well. Well done, very good. So we have a lot of visitors and guests this morning. So reach out to them. Join us for our time of fellowship later this morning after the service. We, on behalf of BC, we welcome you to Bethesda Cathedral. So a couple of announcements this morning. First, Church Camp 2023. You have, as of now, another 16 days. So slightly more than 2 weeks to sign up for the early bird. It is fast filling up. There are not that many seats left. I think after 3 years, this is a great opportunity for the church to gather together, to spend time, to fellowship, to learn of God's word. So you can see the packages up there. If you sign up before the end of the month, okay, this is the prices that's in there. But more importantly, there are very limited seats left. So sign up, pay up by end of this month to confirm your seats. You come after that, no more seats. You got to probably sleep in the car or something. Okay? So that's church camp. Please don't forget to sign up. 2 more Sundays to go. Okay? Next, discipleship classes. So there are a lot of classes being planned and conducted throughout the year. As we build this, rebuild the wall, as we build the church, we must also build our own lives through training, discipleship training, and learning from the God of Word. Okay, so there are courses like intimacy with God that is starting. There is on Thursday night. Okay, there are other sessions that's been coming, starting up as well. So please sign up. I think downstairs or with the church office. And also, the next announcement, Alpha class. Alpha is, we are conducting Alpha training. There will be Alpha sessions being set up. So do take this chance during the Chinese New Year to reach out to your friends, to your family, the pre-believers, okay, to join the Alpha series that will commence after the Chinese New Year. Next announcement, Kids Connect Teachers Training. As we rebuild the church, we also prepare the next generation ahead. We train the generation ahead so that they are also equipped to come in, to serve, to honor God, to do the work and to carry on what needs to be done. So we now need to train up the teachers as well. Okay? We need to train up spiritual fathers and mothers who not only love the children, but will continue to teach them and help them to nurture. So we would like to equip all of you who have this passion and heart for children. We will conduct a proper training, a new curriculum in place, and this training is conducted by an external trainer. Okay, so please sign up. And you can see the details there. Please sign up from the church office if you have a passion and the heart to teach our young ones. Okay? And finally, the last item, okay, there is Sunday service next week. So we know it is the first day of the Chinese New Year. Okay, so please don't just remember to go by Niena. That church service still happens. So we will be here next Sunday, same time, same place. Come and join us first. Honor God on the first day of the Chinese New Year, and then you can go for your Pai Nian. Alright. Now, that's it for announcements this week. So if we can prepare ourselves with a tithe and offering to honor God. Okay, come, let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are the giver of all good things. That everything that we have, every good and perfect gift comes from you. We know that everything that we have received is a blessing from you and you alone. That from you, all good things come. So Father, whatever we have right now, we want to give back a portion to you. Father, we ask that you bless us, bless the giver, bless the tithe and the offering that has been given. Use it powerfully for your work, Lord. That your name be glorified, your kingdom be extended, that your work be done on earth. So Father, we ask for your blessings upon the givers. As we ask all this, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now for the sermon, our speaker this morning is of course someone we know very well. As he continue to speak from the books of James, can we put your hand together and welcome Elder Martin Wong.
Right, good morning brothers and sisters. God bless all of you. It's wonderful to be here and great to see everyone again. And to those who have joined us online, good morning. We are so happy that you can sign in to be with us. And we pray that the Lord will minister to you and be extra close to you as He's here with us. And I fully concur with the opening remarks of Elder Vincent. You know, there's no better place to be. On a Sunday morning, there's no other place we would rather be than to be in the house of the Lord. With our brothers and our sisters, worshiping the Lord with one voice, one fellowship, one family, and one BC. Can I hear a loud amen? Amen. Praise the Lord, because when we come together, iron sharpens iron, correct or not? We edify each other, we encourage each other, we strengthen each other, and giving all praise and glory and honor to the King of Kings and to our Lord of Lords. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. So let's read from James chapter 1. James chapter 1 verse 13 to 18. James chapter 1 verse 13 to 18. It says, "When tempted, no one should say, 'God is tempting me,' for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does He tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all He created." Let us pray. Our gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to thank You for Your presence that's already here in our midst, O God. And Lord, we thank You, Father God, that we can now look into Your Word, and we invite You, Lord, to come and take these words and make it come alive to us. Holy Spirit, we ask You to speak to us, speak to our individual circumstances, our individual situations, O God, and may Your Word bring strength to our hearts this morning. May Your Word bring encouragement, empowerment, healing, restoration, deliverance into our lives. Father, in the name of Jesus, O God, we just pray for Your special anointing right now to be upon all my brothers and sisters who are gathered here, from the left to the right, from the front to the back of the sanctuary, and to all those who are at home, O God. Holy Spirit, may You bring this word and plant it deep within our hearts, that it will fall on good ground and it will bear fruit, O God, fruit that will last. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray against every distracting thoughts in our mind, and we command them to be gone in the name of Jesus, O Lord. And help us now to concentrate and to stay focused on You. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Give the Lord a wonderful hand. Come on, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, brothers and sisters. So this portion of Scripture is a continuation. Okay, it is a continuation from verses 1 to 12 in James chapter 1. And as insightfully shared by Elder Vincent last week, we learned that trials, testings, and temptations are part and parcel in our journey of faith. Right? It's part and parcel of our journey of faith. If we have been, you know, walking with the Lord and we have been living the Spirit-filled, Spirit-empowered life and we encountered some trials and testings last year. How many of us encountered some trials and testings last year? Anybody or not? God or not? God, right? Sure have. I also have trials and testings last year. Rest assured that it is not because, you know, not because we are weird or we are strange or we are sinful or, you know, God has forsaken us. It's none of that. And if we anticipate certain challenges and trials and testings and temptations in 2023, beloved, do not despair. Amen? Do not despair. Don't be afraid, beloved. Trials, testings, and temptations and tribulations is part and parcel of our journey of faith. In fact, James chapter 1 says very clearly, and just to recap, it says when you face trials, not if you face trials, right? When you face trials. So it's part of our journey of faith. And under the sovereignty of our Lord, under the sovereignty of the Lord and His divine plan for all of us, for you and for me, there is a purpose behind these trials, testings, temptations, and tribulations. That we may be mature and complete, right? Verse 3 and verse 4. That we may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So that we can reach the depth and the heights of our faith. Amen. So that His power can be perfected in our weakness. So that His grace can be perfected in our struggles. Many a times, beloved, in the midst of our trials, there will be stress, frustrations, pain, disappointment, dislocation. And you know, it is very difficult to process sometimes, right? To understand and even to comprehend the whys of these trials. Am I right or not? Sometimes it's very hard to understand why, the reasons. And sometimes we might have insight. But many a times, I can tell you, beloved, on this side of heaven, you know, on this side of heaven, we don't have all the answers, like, correct or not? We don't have all the answers. That is why even the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 6, you know, 2 Corinthians 6, 4, 5, he says, you know, as a servant of God, I commend myself. And you know what happened to him? He had to endure great endurance, hardships, troubles, distresses, beatings, imprisonment, riots, sleepless nights and hunger. These were the trials, tribulations, testings, and temptations he went through. And he also goes on to say, you know, through glory and dishonor, even had bad reports. In verse 8, being known as imposters, being unknown, being beaten, being sorrowful, being poor, having nothing. Then take a note, yet possessing everything, amen? Having nothing, yet possessing everything, despite all the challenges, despite all the testings he went through and the temptations and the trials. He knows the promise in James chapter 1, verse 12. As Elder Vincent shared, blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, the person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. Can I hear a loud amen? That's the crown of life for those who endure and persevere. That's why Paul persevered. He said, although I got nothing, yet I have everything. Amen? I have everything. See, there are blessings and rewards from our Lord when we walk, when we hold on to Him, sometimes by our fingernails, you know, holding on to Him, right? And when we remain faithful, when we keep walking with Him, when we walk by faith and not by sight. Amen? When we walk by faith and not by sight. So now in verse 13, beloved, James is continuing on the same topic, okay? James is continuing on the same theme. He's not changing or introducing a new subject here. Okay, whether it is a trial, temptation, test, tribulation, the focus is the same. Because sometimes in the translation of scripture, okay, these words can be used interchangeably. Everybody with me? Is everyone with me? Okay, sometimes these words can be used interchangeably, all right? So of first importance in verse 13, it says, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. Okay, of first importance today, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. God, James' instruction is very clear. It's very clear, beloved. The biggest temptation of all temptations is to blame God for our temptation. Are you with me? Hello? Huh? The biggest temptation of all temptations is to blame God for our temptation. Blame God for our trials and our testings. You see, beloved, the lure of the enemy, the seduction of the enemy is to make us want to spite God. make us want to get angry with God when we face difficult times. That's the seduction of the enemy. Just put the blame on God. You know, give the liability to God. Blame Him as if our God is some, you know, sadistic power up there, you know. Oh, some sadistic power wanting to make us suffer and set up all the traps so that we will fall, you know. Wanting us to fail and collapse, no? No, lah, beloved. That's not our God, amen? That's not our God. But that's the seduction of the enemy. And beloved, consider that the Holy Spirit, moving through James during Bible times, was writing this exhortation because, I want to suggest that because there might have been already reports that the believers in the early church were already blaming God for their hardships. There was probably some reports when James was writing this that there could have been people in the early church already blaming God. Perhaps in the early church, there were lack of resources. There was persecution. There was dissension. Maybe the going was very tough. And so they just blamed God. And so the Holy Spirit moving, James, you know, pen those words now. Don't blame God. Don't blame God. Remember Genesis chapter 3? What happened? What happened when God asked Adam, hey, you ate the fruit? Remember chapter Genesis 3? You ate the fruit? What did Adam say? Genesis 3:12, the man said, the woman you put here, not me. You put the woman here. That's why I ate. Correct or not? Already in Genesis it happened. Not because I ate, you put the woman here, that's why I ate. Blame God. Already started in Genesis, beloved. Remember Job, our good friend Job? He went through tremendous trials, right? Tremendous testings. And in Job chapter 2, verse 9, what was he told? Why are you still maintaining your integrity? Just curse God and die. Simple, right? Just curse God, express your spite, express your anger to God, and die. See, beloved, same in Bible times, same in today. The pressures and the temptation is that when we face serious challenges in our faith, it's just to blame God, walk away, forget about it. Why even walk by faith? You see, brothers and sisters, it was really a privilege. It was truly a privilege to spend some time in Malacca this last week at the Love Singapore Summit. It was a wonderful time. You know, there were over 100 churches, 300 over church leaders, senior pastors, saints, missionaries, and they shared the national agenda for Singapore, right, which is to turn Singapore Godwards, to reach out to the youth, to be a blessing to the nations, right? It's a wonderful summit there. And BC was well represented. I think there were about 8 or 9 people, you know. Senior pastor was there. Oh, yes, can we have some of the pictures? Let's take a look. Yep. The theme of it was called Not Done Yet. You can see our church folks there. Pastor Susan is there. Sister Linda, Brother Huang, is it? Chen Hao. Brother Chen Hao is there. Right? Sister Val and, you know, Cheryl and Pastor Adrian. Where's Joe? Yep, Joe is there. SP is there. Yeah, it was a wonderful time together, beloved. Wonderful time. And we also saw in the picture on the second one, the leadership handover, right? The chairmanship of Love Singapore handed from, you know, Pastor Lawrence Kong to Pastor Jeff Chong now. And we had a wonderful time meeting all our counterparts, you know, in BBTC, Bethesda Frankel, you know, Victory Christian Center, you know. Anglican Church also met one of the bishop or vicar. I don't know what was his designation, you know. Gave a wonderful, wonderful sharing, you know. And the sessions were great. And I tell you, the fellowship was even better, like, especially amongst all of us, like, you know, the BC folks. It was wonderful. There was one night we had dinner. I tell you, we laughed until our stomach ache, you know, stomach pain, you know, stomach cramp, you know. We had so much fun together. Oh, it was really like a mini church camp, I tell you, you know. And as I was sleeping, you know, I was awoken up. I thought someone woke up, started praying in tongues, no, praying in the spirit. I thought, wow, very good, very spiritual, no. And I listened carefully, alamak, snoring la. It's okay, no problem. Snoring means good, huh? That means you can sleep very well, sleep very peaceful, no problem, huh? No problem. But I didn't say who, huh? I didn't say who, huh? No! I don't want my car to get scratched, please, huh? It was like a mini church camp. Like, I tell you, I have a glimpse into the church camp. No? It's wonderful. So all must sign up for church camp. Huh? Okay? Can or not? Okay, yeah? Praise the Lord. Like, it was wonderful. But I want to tell you that in one of those sessions, they had very authentic and transparent sharing by some of the leaders. Some of the church leaders came up and they shared very authentically some of the trials, testings, and tribulations they themselves are going through. And I tell you, those are not, you know, small, oh, I got backache, no, not that kind of thing. One of them, senior leader in the church, his eyesight is failing him. He's going blind. Now he has about, what was it, 10%, did he share? 10% of vision. Can you imagine, brothers and sisters, here you are, serving the Lord, trying to go all out, want to chong for God. You know what's chong for God? And your eyesight is failing. And it's not just the physical challenge, the spiritual struggle, the emotion. How do you reckon? Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Another leader shared that just before he took up, you know, the senior pastor's role in the church, his wife got diagnosed with breast cancer. Oh, I tell you now. And he shared openly. Another leader struggled with a dark cloud of, you know, feeling very burnt out, very drained, very exhausted, and felt like giving up. Brothers and sisters, these are leaders in the church, senior, and they're sharing very openly that they are also facing trials, testings, temptations, and tribulations. And they are staying the course. They are persevering. They could have easily blamed God, easily cursed God and die, but they are not blaming God. Like James, they are persevering under trial because they know that when they stand their test, they will receive their crown of life. Amen. And like Paul, he's standing to testify that despite the challenges they face, in Christ, they have everything. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I look at my two brothers, Pastor Adrian, Brother Joseph. I cannot tell you how delighted I am that they are led by the Lord to return and to serve in BC, standing shoulder to shoulder with our leadership team, driving critical ministries in our church. And I've known them for years, brothers and sisters, and I can tell you that these brothers have been through the fire. Their faith have been tested by fire. Their ministries have been tested by fire. Some literally fire, you know. Literal fire, you know. Their lives have been tested by fire. These are folks who have walked through the valley of the shadow of death. Are you with me? And they've had their fair share of trials, testings, and tribulations. We've known each other since we were wearing short pants, you know. No joke, you know. And they could have easily blamed God. Stop. Sees everything, no need to continue. And anyone who is made of less than sterner stuff than them would have just packed up and balik kampong lah. Would have just gone. And the fact that they are still standing here today is a testimony of their confidence in God and the faithfulness and goodness of our Lord. Can I hear a loud amen? Amen. Come on, give the Lord a wonderful hand, brothers and sisters. See, Hebrews chapter 10, 35, 36 says, don't throw away your confidence. Don't throw away your confidence. It will be richly. What does it say? It will be richly. Praise the Lord. Don't throw away your confidence in God. We need to persevere. And when we have done the will of God, we will receive what He has. Say louder, 1, 2, 3, we will receive what He has. Promise. So in 2023, may the Holy Spirit help us to always, always put God on the throne. Even when we encounter temptations, trials, testings, tribulations. May the Holy Spirit help us in our spiritual resolution. How many of you started the year and said that I got New Year resolution? Go on. I got? Have, right? We have New Year resolution, right? One of the most common New Year resolutions is, you know what? Is to lose. Whose resolution is that? Okay, don't raise your hand. No need to raise. It's to lose weight. If we can have earthly resolutions, can we have spiritual resolutions or not? Can or not? Yes. Can or cannot? Yes. Can. We can have spiritual resolutions. And I pray that one of the spiritual resolutions is to always enthrone our Lord and never to blame or to dethrone our God. In fact, when we go through trials, testings, temptations, tribulations, all the more we must praise Him. All the more we must declare His greatness and exalt His name even more. Jeremiah 17, 7-8. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord again, whose confidence is in Him. Where are we placing our confidence in 2023? Is it on the market outlook 2023? Hey, the prognosis is not very good, no? Whether it's the war, like inflation, like interest rates, like, you know, on the brink of recession, like da-da-da-da-da. Hey, don't put your confidence in the wrong thing. Put your confidence in the Lord. Look at what it says in verse 8. Like a tree planted by the water, it does not fear when heat comes. So will heat come or not? Can, right? Heat can come, huh? But don't fear. Do not fear when heat comes. It has no worries in a year of drought because we will never fail to bear fruit. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. So of first importance, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. Of first importance. Or second importance. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Of second importance, verse 4, but each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. The issue is not the temptation or the trial or the test. That's not the problem. James teaches us clearly that it is not the external stimuli. It's not what is on the outside that is the problem. The Bible teaches us, the Bible reminds us that God's character, His very nature, His very DNA is not constructed for Him to tempt us, you know, and to trick us and to deceive us so that we fall and we fail. That's not how His DNA is constructed. The choice to sin has nothing to do with God or the situation that we are facing. Just a quick verse to kind of wrap what God is in 1 John 4:16. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us, because God is, say loudly everyone, God is love. That's the definition of God. God does not just love us. He doesn't just give us love. God is the very definition of love. Not I say, the Bible say. God is love. God is love. That's His very DNA. And in Psalms 1, 4, 5, 8, and 9, He's not just love. He doesn't just love us. He is gracious. He is compassionate. He is slow to anger. He is rich in love because He is love. So He's not out to trick us or to set up trials and testing so that we all sin and fail and, you know, get ourselves into a mess. No. He's slow to anger. Even when we mess up, He's slow to anger. Different from me, you know, I'm quick to anger, you know. Oh, you're so sorry to have to say that. It's so embarrassing, I tell you, you know. Even yesterday, you know, I tell you, so funny, you know. In the home, around 10, 11, we were supposed to go out or something. I don't know, over some silly, insignificant timing, this talking, you know, what to do. My voice suddenly became like, from channel 1 became channel 20, you know. Suddenly the volume went out like a parade commander, you know. I was talking to my daughter. And I don't know what riled me up. My volume suddenly became so loud. No? Oh, I could see in her eyes all the water, the tears going to Niagara Falls already. No? Going to cry already. No? Then she tell me, Daddy, you're shouting at me. I said, sorry. Baby daddy said sorry already. See, it's nothing to do with outside. You understand what I mean? No? But sometimes the trigger just make the volume sound, I don't know, no? But God is slow to anger. To sin against our Lord when we face trials, testings, temptations, and tribulations is not because of God. The nexus of sin lies internally. Are you with me? It lies internally. It comes from within. When we are dragged away by our own evil desires, it comes from what scholars call the endemic nature. You know Adam? They call Adam the endemic nature. That we inherited since the fall in Genesis. Everyone with me? When the fall happened in Genesis, all of us, you, me, everyone, inherited the endemic nature. That sinful nature, that disobedient nature. This is the sinful nature that all of mankind since the Garden of Eden has. This is what drags us down the path of disobedience, rebellion, and sin. This is what triggered in me that suddenly my volume can get so loud and I have to apologize, forgive. I'm so sorry that He loves you, I'm so sorry. This is the endemic nature. And this results in us transgressing God's ways and God's principles. Romans 5:12 says, just as sin entered the world through one man. And who is this one man? We said just now, what's his name? Let's say louder. Adam. One man. Death came to all people because all sinned. Now, the New Living Translation is very, very explicit. When Adam sinned, very clear already. Sin entered the world. When Adam sinned, that's where it all began. Adam's sin brought death, so death spread to everyone, for everyone's sin. So it is this endemic nature expressing itself through what the Bible teaches as our flesh. Have you all heard of that before? Yes? It expresses itself through our flesh. Whether it is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, they all come back to the root of our endemic nature. Everything that revolves around our illicit physical appetites or our insatiable demands for wanting more and more and more, and every sense of self-sufficiency and self-righteousness that we have, these are the inner weaknesses, the evil desires that James talked about that will entrap us into sin. To do it our way, to disobey God, and to transgress His commandments. Galatians 5:17 tells us, the flesh will desire what is contrary to the Spirit. It will desire what is contrary. What the Spirit of God wants, the flesh don't want. What the flesh wants, the Spirit of God doesn't want. Are you with me? They are in conflict with each other. This is the conflict. And transformation happens when we move from the kingdom of darkness and be transformed more and more and more and more into our Lord, into the image of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen? That's the transition. But they're always in conflict. But that's the transition all of us here are embarking upon. The endemic nature also manifests itself through the mind that is not renewed. So one, through the flesh. And number two, through the mind that is not renewed. This is what Scripture teaches called the carnal mind. Have we heard of it before? The carnal mind. This is the mind that is worldly in thinking, corrupted by the standards of the world, that is unable to take reference from God's principles. It just cannot understand God's principles because the mind is not renewed. It's still carnal in thinking, worldly in thinking. Romans 8 verse 6 says, the mind governed by the flesh is what? Is death. See, the mind governed by the flesh is death. But the mind governed by the Spirit, praise the Lord, is life and peace. Amen. It's life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It cannot submit to God's law. So, brothers and sisters, to help us align with God's word, just want to share some what I call diagnostic questions. Okay, diagnostic questions to help us identify the flesh, identify the carnal mind. Okay, these are just 7 diagnostic questions. Do we seek to glorify self and seek self-aggrandizement? Number one. Number two, is our ego and pride the most important thing? Do we always need to be right? Number three, do we desire pleasure without boundaries? Pleasure without boundaries. Number four, can we forgive or must we get even? Must get even, you know. Number five, do we seek for more and more and more and more and more? Number six, are we tight-fisted? So tight-fisted that we cannot share, we cannot give, we cannot let other people go first. Number seven, must we always be served and we cannot serve others? Now, these are just 7 diagnostic questions, and it's just to help us awaken. If there are elements that we need to bring to the Lord to humble ourselves and to bring it under the blood, amen? To bring it under the blood. It's not to beat ourselves up, because even the Apostle Paul struggled with this. Beloved, even the Apostle Paul struggled with this in Romans 7, verse 15. He says, I don't understand. I don't understand. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. See, even the Apostle Paul struggled with this. So like Paul, as long as we're on this side of heaven, the enemy will seek to exploit our weaknesses in our endemic nature. The trials, testings, temptations, tribulations are only external circumstances. They don't create sin, and it's not sin in itself. It is when we respond in the flesh, when we respond with carnal thinking, that this carnal and fleshly desire will be conceived, as James said, and will give birth to sin, and the sin, when it is fully grown up, will give birth to death. So brothers and sisters, in 2023, may the Holy Spirit help us to walk in the Spirit. Amen? To walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh. May one of our spiritual resolutions that the Holy Spirit will transform us by renewing our mind so that our words and actions will flow from a life in the Spirit. And may we resolve to take up our cross daily and follow Him, to put the old nature to death. Amen? To put the old nature to death and to follow Jesus, to take up our cross. I know there are not, some preachers don't believe in taking up our cross. Easy Christian life, no need to crucify your old self. That's not what the Bible tells me. Take up our cross daily, follow after Jesus. Count ourselves dead to sin, but alive unto God in Christ Jesus. For what is a man's advantage if he gains the whole world and yet he forfeits his soul? So Romans 8:13-14. For if we live according to the flesh, we will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, we will live. Amen and amen and amen. So brothers and sisters, please turn to your neighbor. Turn to your neighbor, give them a nudge. Let's walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh. Come on, turn to your neighbor. Walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh. Let that be our 2023 resolution. So our first importance, verse 13, just to recap. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. All right? Second importance, but each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Of third importance, brothers and sisters, in verse 17, every good and perfect gift is from above. Read that again. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like the shifting shadows. God is consistent. God is love. God is love since Bible. God is love from the beginning. He's consistent. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights. So brothers and sisters, after James addressed the issue that God does not tempt, all right? He addressed the issue God does not tempt, God doesn't set us up for failure. And after setting the record straight that, you know, of teaching where does sin emanate from, where does sin come from, right? He already addressed all those topics. He closes this topic and in verse 16, that's the change to tell us, don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Don't be deceived anymore. Are you with me? Don't be deceived. Clarified already. Do not be deceived. We know God's nature, God's character. We know He doesn't tempt us, doesn't set us up for failure. We know where the issue lies. That's why we must take up our cross and follow after Him daily and walk in the Spirit and live the new man that's created to be like Christ, Jesus. Therefore, He says now, don't be deceived. Have clarity in our thought. Don't be deceived anymore. And with this teaching provided, the way forward is now to guard and strengthen our hearts and minds so as to fulfill God's plan and purpose for our lives. That's the way forward. So that as James 1:18 says, we can become the first fruits He created. The first fruits He created. James 1:18. Be a kind of first fruits of all He created. And every time the scripture brings about this word first fruits, you and I know that it has to do with offering, right? Offering your first fruits. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? It's about offering. It's about an act of worship. You are setting aside the first fruit after you get the harvest. You know why? You get the best, and you offer to God, right? You want to offer God third best, fourth best, fifth best or not? What or not? No. You offer God the first fruits, the best. That's why when we receive, you know, whatever we are paid, we give the tithe, the one-tenth, give to God first. The first fruits is a picture. Beloved, a spiritual picture for us this morning. It is a spiritual picture of our lives. being an offering, a fragrant offering, bringing the best offering unto our God that is acceptable to our Lord. Amen? It's an offering that our lives can be an offering to the Lord. And brothers and sisters, James provides us some insights, you know. He gives us some insights by reminding us that our Father has already given to us all that we need for life and godliness. Our Father has given to us everything we need in life and godliness. God, our Heavenly Father. And as our Heavenly Father, I want to share and ask us to consider three good and perfect gifts that He has already given to us. Remember, the scripture says, every good and perfect gift is from above. So I want to share with you three good and perfect gifts that God has already given to us to help us in our journey of faith. The first gift, Acts 2:38. Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Peter said to them, repent each of you, be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. What is the first gift? The gift of the Holy Spirit. This is the good and perfect gift that He has already given to us. The first good and perfect gift is the gift of the Holy Spirit. He is God's gift to us, to you and to me, to teach us, to help us bear fruit, to help us in our weaknesses, to remind us of His words that He has spoken to us, to direct us on the path of truth. The Holy Spirit is our seal for the day of redemption. Amen? It is our seal for the day of redemption. And the Holy Spirit will always direct us to our Lord Jesus, because He will always glorify Jesus. Amen? He will always glorify Jesus. The Holy Spirit is God's gift for you and for me. And brothers and sisters, I think in 2023, we need more of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We need more of the Holy Spirit, beloved. Not by mind, not by power, but by thy? Hey, you're so soft, huh? Not by mind, not by power, but by thy? Amen. Spirit. We need more of the Holy Spirit in 2023. Try to run on our own strength, ah. Pamche lah. Stop ready lah. Give up ready lah. Right? Give up ready. We need more of the Holy Spirit. Some of us need a fresh infilling of the Spirit. Have or not, brothers and sisters? Be honest, right? Some of us need a fresh infilling. Some of us have been drained out. One of the things I learned from your founding pastor is that you may have received an infilling, you know, a long time ago, but along the way, you can leak, no? You know what I mean? I can leak, no? And then after a while, even the gas tank, from full, slowly become empty. So we need to be refreshed. We need to be refreshed. Constantly refreshed. Regularly refreshed. Just because we have been baptized in the Spirit 20 years ago doesn't mean we don't have to be refreshed today. Correct or not? We need to be refreshed. Regularly. Approach your leaders, approach your pastors, approach your elders. Ask them to pray for you for a fresh impartation of the Spirit. Go home, get on your knees, call out to God, Lord, I want a fresh impartation of your Spirit. Fresh zeal for 2023. Fresh anointing for 2023. Fresh wisdom for 2023. I want that fresh infilling. If 2021, our level was here, 2022, our level here, 2023, where should our level be? Higher or here? Who wants to be here? No. 2022 here, 2023 here, amen? Amen or not? Amen. We want to be here with the Spirit's empowerment, amen? Yes. Amen. Worship team, can we get ready now to help close? So that's the first gift. The second gift, the second good and perfect gift that He has given to us, 1 Peter 4:10 to 11. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. Anyone who serves, they should do so with the strength that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. So each of us must use whatever gift we have received. The good and perfect gift, the second good and perfect gift, are the giftings God already placed in our hands. Beloved, as we close today, someone look at your hands and says, God, what have you already given to me? No one here is without a gift, brothers and sisters. Look at your hands and says, God, what have you already given me? It's already in our hands. And the instruction from Scripture is to use it to serve others. Amen? Use it to serve others. All the skills, all the capabilities that we have been given are to be used to serve His people and the community. The time, the talent, the treasures that God has given to us, it's already in our hands. Don't have to look so far away. Hey God, what was my spiritual gift? God already is in your hands. Brothers and sisters, recall that we serve God by serving His people, and we serve His people by serving God. Amen? We serve God by serving His people, and we serve His people by serving God. In 2023, brothers and sisters, what is your gift? What is my gift? What is our gift? If we have not been served, can we go and find it? Can we go and look for it or not, brothers and sisters? Can or not? Can we go and open the cupboards and start looking for those gifts? Dust off, wipe off the dust. Let's use our gifts in 2023. Because when we serve the Lord with our gifts, that good and perfect gift, we are becoming a steward of His grace. Amen? A steward, an instrument of His grace. How many of us here want to be instruments of God? Can I see your hand? How many of us? Come on! We want to be instruments of God's grace. A steward of His grace. Some of us may think, I'm just an usher on Sunday. I just stand there. At the most, I just give out a tract. That's all, you know. I'm telling you, brothers, let's not think so small. As an usher, your warm greeting, your genuine handshake may be the loving welcome that someone needs. Are you with me? It may be the loving welcome that someone needs. Someone who felt depressed. Someone who have, mental stress. Someone who feel unloved. Someone who rejected by society. Your loving welcome may be the love that person needs. And God using you to touch that person by your genuine love and welcome. That's why every time you board SIA, they greet you with a big smile. Correct or not? It's a great way to fly, right? Yeah. They make you feel welcome. Like as if you're coming home, you know. All right. Become a steward and an instrument of His grace. So in 2023, let's go and get our gifts. Come on, grab our gifts and use it for the Lord's glory. That God may be praised forevermore. And amen and amen. Third gift, and then we close. The third gift, the good and perfect gift, number three, Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, the perfect and good gift of God, is eternal life in Christ Jesus. This is the third good and perfect gift. In fact, it is the greatest gift. It's the gift of His Son who went to the cross to take away our sins, your sins and my sins. And He came to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to set the captives free. He came to destroy the works of the enemy. He came to give us life and life abundantly. He came to heal the brokenhearted. He came to bring light to this dark world and to bring light to the dark situation that we are facing. And He came to give us eternal life. Beloved, remember we saw death came from Adam, right? But life comes from Jesus. Amen? Death comes from Adam, but life comes from Jesus. That's why in the Bible it says, Jesus is the last Adam. He settled it all. He settled it all. Adam fell, sin came. Jesus came, now we have eternal life. Amen? That is why, despite his inner struggles, his sinful struggles, Paul says in Romans 7, 24, 25. I may not have given it to the sound crew, I apologize. Romans 7, 24, 25. It says, "What a wretched man I am. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death?" And there's the answer. "Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord." That's the answer. Who is going to deliver us from this fallen endemic nature? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that's the answer, beloved. To walk in the Spirit is victory in the name of Jesus. Amen. So in 2023, brothers and sisters, let us go forth. Let us go forth and tell unsafe grandma, unsafe grandpa maybe, unsafe mom, unsafe dad, unsafe brother or sister, unsafe friends. Tell them about Jesus. Tell them there is a Savior. And His name is Jesus. What we have is God's gift to us. Correct or not? What we have is God's gift to us. What we do with those gifts is our gift back to God. Are you with me? So do not keep those gifts to ourselves, brothers and sisters. Don't hoard those gifts. Don't sit on those gifts. Every one of us here, share those gifts. Share the love. Share the gospel of truth. And as the Spirit enables us, in 2023, His kingdom will advance and we will all move forward in faith. Shall we all rise? Let's lift our hands and let's pray together. Our gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, Lord, this morning we rededicate ourselves afresh to You, to follow in the footsteps of our blessed Lord Jesus, who came not to be served but to serve. Lord, we make ourselves available to You, that in 2023 we will be Your hands, Your feet, to care for others like how You, Lord, care for us. Lord, in 2023, may Your Holy Spirit fill our hearts again to overflowing. May Your love strengthen our inner man for every good work, to be obedient to Your word and to go and to do likewise. May we yield our lives fully to our great Shepherd, so that we may always give honor to Your name with lives of service unto You, in the name of the risen Christ. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people say, amen. Give the Lord a wonderful hand. Praise the Lord. Spirit, use me.
the most perfect, most wonderful gift is the gift of the Holy Spirit and of the Son. Come, let's lift our hands. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, of life eternal, of love ever flowing. Father, I release in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, your peace, your joy, your covering, now and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Service is over. We'll see you downstairs for fellowship. God bless.
Walk humbly with you.